Come on down to the Law Student Lounge with your host, attorney Ryan McKeen, where law students like you tell their stories. So pull up a chair and join us in the lounge.
Hi, everyone. It's Connecticut attorney Ryan McKeen from Connecticut Trial Firm, and today I'm here with Maggie Murolo. I had the good fortune of meeting Maggie at a UConn Law career fair back in February. She's an outstanding law student. She comes to law with a unique background. We're going to get all into that. But anyhow, I am so excited to have Maggie on this episode of the Law Student Lounge. Welcome, Maggie.
Yes, Attorney McKeen, thank you so much for having me. I'm very excited to participate. I've listened to a bunch of the podcasts that you've already posted, so I'm excited to be a part of this as well. And I wish it was something that I could have listened to when I was first considering law school.
That is awesome. So let's just start there. Let's jump right in, Maggie. First, well, actually, let's give the audience some background on who is Maggie Murolo.
So I'm a Leo, which a lot of people tell me they can tell when they first start talking to me. I have the unique background. I've been a nurse for about the last 10 years. So I'm making a big career change and pivot into the legal realm, which I'm very excited to bring my background and my skills into this new transition. And I'm a Connecticut born and bred and hoping to stay here for the bulk of my career.
That is awesome. So you are a nurse for about 10 years. Can you tell us a little bit about what you did in nursing and really what led to your decision to come to law school?
Definitely. So I was fortunate enough to be able to try on a lot of different nursing hats. My first nursing position, I did some volunteer work out in California with the Jesuit Volunteer Corps, and I did primary care out there. And that was a wonderful experience to be able to learn from such interesting and well-versed practitioners. After that, I started my own healthcare consulting firm, and I provided advice on how to achieve accreditation and other things such as how you should do your staffing and creating policies and procedures on what best practices were in an ambulatory care setting. After that, I did post-acute rehab for patients that had just come out of surgeries or other types of procedures where they needed a little extra support. And then I transitioned into acute care at a hospital in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and I did what they call float nursing. So they would send you wherever there was a need that day. So I was able to learn about med surg, psychiatry, maternity, ER, ICU. So I really have run the gambit and worn many different hats as a nurse, which has only helped me learn. And that's one of my favorite things, is being versatile and being able to learn a lot. And that's kind of what led me into a legal career. I really thought, you know, what's next for me? I always knew I wanted to go back to school, and I wanted to be able to utilize the skills and expertise that I had honed in the last 10 years. And a lot of the things that I think make me a great nurse will translate well into being a great attorney, you know, being able to triage, being able to talk about difficult topics with clients or patients, being able to work as a team, but also knowing how to do things independently, I think will really help me. Similarly, what really got my brain going in this, I was in a car accident in 2018, and one of the attorneys that I worked with was a nurse attorney, and she kind of explained her transition into how she became a lawyer as well. And I was like, oh, I could do that. That kind of makes sense for me too. All the things that I like doing, I like interacting with clients, I like thinking outside of the box, I like seeing things from start to finish. It really just matched my personality.
That is interesting. I was also inspired to go to law school really from being involved in a car accident in 1998. So I can absolutely relate to that. And so you have this moment, you're in the car accident and you're being represented by a lawyer, and this lawyer tells you these things. And is there a moment where you're like, okay, I'm going to take the LSAT, or I want to go to law school? Like, how did you begin that research process?
So it had always been in the back of my mind, like fourth grade career day, I picked lawyer. So it's always been something I thought about, but I think I was just hesitant about the idea of going back to school and really immersing myself in getting to that point where I was 100% committed to really putting all my effort into doing well in school. For me, what was very beneficial was just talking to anyone that I knew that was a lawyer and seeing their perspective. Also, like, I'm not shy, so I reached out to people on, like, different platforms. If I just knew somebody's name, I wasn't scared to email them, like, cold email them, be like, hey, my name's Maggie. I'm a nursing student. If you have the ability to just meet with me for coffee or chat with me virtually, I would love to just hear about where you got to where you are today and how that worked. So really just talking to people is what I did. And then in terms of preparing for the LSAT and getting into law school, I did a lot of my like Google research where I looked at, you know, based on my background and the grades that I had and the grades that I was getting on practice LSATs, like what ranges I would be appropriate for, what types of school I might be able to apply to or get into. And the most beneficial for me was doing an LSAT preparatory class. I did one that was in person and one that was online, and I took it really serious. Like, I cut my hours at work so that I could spend a certain amount of hours every week. I treated it like a job. And I think that really made all the difference for me, really helped increase my scores. And it's unfortunate, but a lot of schools do look at what your LSAT scores are. So I really think putting in the time and effort there helped me in the long run and made law school a much more attainable goal for me.
Now, let's unpack some of what you just said here. You said, I mean, essentially, Maggie, you said that you were cold calling lawyers. So you'd find them maybe on LinkedIn or you just knew somebody. What was the response when you did that from lawyers?
So for the most part, at least what I have seen is lawyers like to talk. So most of the time, some people didn't respond at all. But for the most part, many people were very willing to meet with me. They'd be like, okay, I can give you 30 minutes on Tuesday at 8 o'clock or 10 o'clock or whatever. But they would be willing to talk to me and they'd be willing to share their experiences. And even now I do that to ask attorneys, like, do you like the practice area that you're in now? But luckily, you know, most people have been pretty receptive and have been open to want to provide guidance.
That's what I hoped you were going to say, because it's been my experience as a lawyer and as a law student is one of the great things about law, and it's not necessarily something you would think, is that there's a lot of lawyers who are really willing to help other lawyers or people wanting to become lawyers. So when you get that email, you get that that call or that ask, there are lots of people out there who are willing to give their time and to have that talk and to provide that guidance. And I think it's because, like, you know, look, law is fundamentally a people profession where we, you know, our colleagues matter tremendously. Our ability to, you know, I don't know of any lawyer that gets into their position without being helped out. So just to capture that, I mean, for a law student out there or for somebody thinking about going to law school, yeah, don't hesitate to cold call. Don't hesitate to reach out. Like, find the email. I know it feels maybe uncomfortable or maybe like you're burdening them, but probably the worst that happens is they just ignore you. But I think you're going to find a lot of lawyers out there, a lot of people in the legal profession who are willing to try to help you out in some way. And you never know what you're going to get from those calls. And I know when I was a law student, thinking back to that, you know, those conversations impacted my career and changed the trajectory of my career. And I sort of look at it, I think, like many lawyers do, which is just a way to pay it forward. So that is excellent advice. That is excellent advice right there. So how, Maggie, do you, so you study for the LSAT, you take your LSAT prep course. How do you decide where it is that you want to go to law school?
So some of the best advice that I got actually about where to go to law school was to go to law school in the area that you hope to practice in. So for me, I knew that I wanted to be in Connecticut after law school. So I knew a Connecticut law school was the choice for me. And then ultimately, it came down to what was going to be the best bang for my buck and what would be the better ranked or better networking connections after law school. So for me, what I thought about was there's three law schools in Connecticut. So I had to, I narrowed it down to three. And based on scholarship opportunities and ranking, that's how I made my choice. I did apply to more schools outside of the state as well, just to increase my chances in case I wasn't fortunate enough to get into a position where I would be able to go to a school in Connecticut. But for me, what I thought about was, what do I want my life to look like after law school? And what type of tuition and tuition payments would allow me to get there? And in talking with some of these attorneys that I mentioned previously, I talked to them about the importance of networking and alumni connections. And that was a big piece for me. I go to UConn Law School, and a lot of the attorneys that I spoke to talked about how they formed very formative interactions with their peers during law school. And many of them started their firms with people that were in their sections from law school. So I really wanted to create a community of people that I could work with in the future. So that's what helped me decide to go to UConn as well.
That is great advice. And I always, I give the same advice, which is to, if you're thinking about law school, think about where it is that you want to live after law school. I remember, Maggie, when I was in college, I was like, you know what? It would be awesome to spend 3 years in Hawaii. So maybe I'll apply to University of Hawaii. But do I really want to practice law in Hawaii? No. Like, I could not see myself like moving that far from family, because family is important to me. And my family's all on the East Coast. So I was not going to do that. But generally, yes, like almost all of law, like, I mean, I know there's law school rankings and there's all these different things, but really what it boils down to is law is a series of like small communities. And so, many lawyers in Hartford, I mean, probably 80% of lawyers in like the Hartford area where I am, like they went to Quinnipiac, UConn, or Western New England, like those three schools. And yes, the networks that are there, the familiarity that's there, hey, did you have Professor Baker? Oh, I had Professor Baker. And the sort of common experience, because I think even if you went to school in like a large city like New York, like you're going to find lawyers who actually practice in New York, maybe not at the biggest firms, they're going to draw from all over, but the legal community at large is a local community. So going to where it is that you want to practice, I think, is incredibly smart advice. And also, it's not like, I don't want anybody out there listening thinking like, oh my gosh, I went to University of Nebraska and I want to practice in Connecticut. Like, that is completely doable. Like, you will be okay if you do that. You will be okay if you change course. You will be okay no matter what, really, if you are willing to work at it. But I think it is a very efficient advice to say, okay, this is where I want to live, and get out into that community, start meeting people in that community, start building out that reputation and networking. I think it is very critical. So that is really important advice. And obviously, I think the advice too about, you know, graduating as little debt as possible and getting a good LSAT is also very, very important. So if you could go back and talk to Maggie of maybe 4 years ago and say, you know, what advice would you give to yourself when you're applying to law school, if you had to do it all over again?
Let me think. So in applying to law school, I would say definitely look on the LSAT website to see, they have a section that'll show you based on your score what the average is for the schools that you're looking for. So that kind of helped me narrow down like where I might be a good fit based on my score. And of course, that's not the only thing that schools consider. So also thinking ahead of time about what your personal essay is going to be about, like starting to churn those ideas a little bit earlier so you're not rushing to write an essay and doing something that's really impactful and meaningful to you. And also ahead of time, reaching out to recommenders and recommenders that you think can make a difference. You know, not just choosing someone generic who can write a letter for you, choosing somebody who really knows your background or really will put you in a position to have a good opportunity to get into the school that you want. So for me, I was lucky enough, I went to UConn undergrad. So one of my recommenders, I was able to use a teacher from UConn, and then I applied to UConn Law School. So the law school faculty knew my recommender, and I think that made a difference. They even reached out to my recommender after the fact and thanked her for providing one. So really, again, like what I realized is how important networking is. And similarly, when I was preparing for the LSAT and preparing for getting into law school, like I said, I cold emailed some of the administration at UConn Law. I was like, hey, I'm really interested. How can I learn more about the program? How can I learn more about the opportunities? And if nothing else, it gets your name out there and it gets them thinking about you and recognizing that you're willing to go the extra step and you're willing to put yourself out there for what you want. But I guess the best advice for preparing for the LSAT and preparing for law school would be do things as much in advance as you can and at least start thinking about things as much in advance as possible.
So you apply to law school, you get accepted, you choose UConn. Can you tell me about like what those first, you know, for somebody who's thinking, you know, we're recording this here in beginning of August, or I guess it's still the beginning, it's the 7th of August. And so for people who are going to be, you know, starting up in law school in a few weeks, what was the first few weeks of law school like for you?
So law school, coming from a nursing science background, law school was a complete whirlwind. Even the way that you have to think about things, like in nursing, things are very black and white, you know, like this is what the mitochondria is. And then coming to law school, it's all shades of gray. A lot of what I've learned is like, there are no rules. There is no right answer. It's can you really show the left side and the right side and the in-between and what you think the outcome will be. So really being comfortable with the idea of knowing that there's not always going to be a concrete answer that a professor is looking for. Another thing about law school that's very different is the idea of being self-motivated in your studies. There's not, in most classes, there, at least at UConn, there aren't tests every couple of weeks. There aren't multiple assignments that you have to turn in for a lot of your core classes. It's one final exam at the end of the semester, so you don't have a lot of feedback on how well you're doing. There's not things to keep you on track and keep you accountable. You really have to be self-motivated and create schedules for yourself. Like, professors will give a syllabus of what they're going to cover that day and readings that they'll cover that day, but if you aren't on top of your things, nobody's really watching you or making sure that you're doing what you should be. So that was a big adjustment as well. I was used to a course load where there were more opportunities for intervention or getting back on track. Whereas law school, the first couple weeks, it was like, here's a ton of reading, figure it out. So what was most helpful for me was I have a planner that I live by, and I would plan out for the whole semester. Okay, like this is what's going to be due this day. This is when I could work on it. And this is when finals are going to be, and really going throughout the semester and doing extra work throughout the semester, doing like recaps and study guides throughout the semester was very helpful. And at the beginning of law school, one thing that was huge for me was I felt like previously I was a big fish in a small pond. Like I got good grades. I was talkative. I was confident. I was good at a lot of different things. Whereas coming to law school, everyone is very good at everything. Everyone's a great talker. Everyone has great grades. Everyone was, you know, excellent and had this wonderful background and had so much to offer. So my advice would be not to feel overwhelmed by that, but feel fortunate to know that you were chosen because you belong there too. So a lot of people use that thing, imposter syndrome. So like, stay away from that. You're there because you deserve to be there. You were chosen. You are capable, and the people around you can only add and be a benefit to you. You don't need to compete with them. You can be a resource for each other.
That is wonderful advice, because I don't know anybody who has gone to law school who hasn't been challenged in that way. Like that is a natural part of the process. Like, law school should challenge you. Like, you should be like, oh my gosh, like, these people are really smart. This is really challenging. And for a lot of people, like, that's right. That could be uncomfortable. It could be the first time in your life that it has happened at that level of intensity, but it's okay. And I always think that, you know, there were people, and most people in my law school class experienced exactly what you just described. And there were some who liked to fake it. They were confident, and it was doubtless. And then a lot of times those people were the ones who got humbled by grades. so just as you're going through it, like, it is there. And you also touched upon something upon your peers. One of the great gifts in my life, I think, has been my law school classmates. Like, especially like my 1L first year section, where you're all in a section together. I mean, some very, very deep relationships in my life, you know, stem from that experience. Can you talk a little bit about, like, and again, you go to law school a little bit older for the audience, like, you were like 10 years between or 7 years between college and law school?
Yeah, so I'm, I guess, what they call an atypical student. I'm 32 years old now, 32 in a couple days. Coming in, having a successful career already, I was in a different position than some of my peers. But it's been very fortunate, because being in class with people that are of a different mindset or have grown up in different circumstances and different time frames has been very beneficial, at least to our discourse within class about ways of thinking or why we think the way that we think. So it's actually been great to interact with people from such diverse backgrounds. That's one thing that I also really liked about UConn, was that they had a high percentage of atypical students as well. So some of the people that I'm in class with, one of my friends used to be an opera singer and lived in Europe, and another one was a paramedic, and another one was also a nurse, and another one, like, many people are coming with such wealth of knowledge that they could bring in such unique perspectives that it's been wonderful to just really be challenged to think differently and to learn from the people around you. And I always think I think about life and my career kind of like playing chess. I'm always like, okay, what are my next 10 steps? So in the future too, like, just creating this network, you mentioned that you're still friends with a lot of people from school. You don't know where life is going to lead you and what path you're going to be on. You never know, like, where you might interact with these people again. You know, you might be specializing in one type of law and a classmate specializing in another, and you guys are a referral source for each other. Or at different events that you want to put on, maybe you're going to be teaching a CLE and you know that one of your classmates was really good in this content area, and that's someone that you can reach out to later. So everyone is an opportunity to connect with them later in life as well. Like, your journey doesn't stop with the people that you went to law school with upon graduation. I anticipate, everybody always says Connecticut is such a small bar. So if you're planning on practicing in Connecticut or working somewhere where you go to school and then practice in that same area, you have such an opportunity to figure out who might be a great resource and who you might be a great resource for as well.
That is all great advice. And I mean, I think it's commonly said that, like, your reputation as a lawyer begins in law school. And I think that is true. And so you have a really positive chance to, yes, your peers are going to, if you allow it, enrich your life. And it just may be in many ways, not even if it's like a business way. I mean, like, I still play fantasy baseball with a league we started as a 1L that's going into its 20th season. But we've had people who, you know, their daughters have had cancer, and we've rallied around to raise money for, you know, meal trains and things like that for them. And yeah, their experiences and their networks and just their companionship, I think, is a wonderful thing, not to be alone on this journey. And oftentimes, you find that where people start is not where they end up. And it's really fun to watch play out over the course of your career, who ends up doing what. I have classmates who were sure that they wanted to be lawyers, and now they're on the FBI SWAT team, and others who decided they wanted to be a prosecutor and now a town manager, people who wanted to do criminal defense, and now they're doing cybersecurity. They have a cybersecurity insurance company that deals with like Lloyd's of London. So these are all things that you know, I think are sort of unforeseeable career paths in many ways that your colleagues are going to take. And you know, yet the people left to the left and right of you are those people. So that is a wonderful opportunity for you. Now you come at law school with, I went to law school with some doctors, some nurses, but you also come at it from a unique, I think, perspective, which is an entrepreneurial one. Like you have been self-employed. How is that, or, you know, what lessons did you learn from self-employment that you have applied to law school in your career?
Certainly. So one of the things that I wish there was more training on in law school is the idea of starting a business. I don't think that most law students get a lot of background onto the business part of law, which is a very real aspect of it. It's not just how well do you know the law and how well can you zealously advocate for a client. It's can you also do client acquisition? Can you also maintain a place where staff want to continue working with you? Can you figure out how to do the books and how to meet all the regulations you need to meet? So that is something that I think my background in healthcare consulting and having my own company will be useful going forward. Being able to think about the whole picture, not just can I finish the tasks that are ahead of me, like the motion I have to file this day or the paper or the brief that I have to get done by tomorrow. It's how do I enhance my image? And how do I create a space that people want to be a part of? So I think that will help me going forward. At this point, I haven't really noticed too much of that in play yet, but I am hopeful that once I begin my career, I can implement some of those activities.
You know, those are incredibly important lessons out there. And you're right, they're ones that law school doesn't teach. In part, they don't teach it because people who are generally law professors don't go down that career path, right? They go to law school, they do well, they go to a, you know, federal clerkship, and then they go on to maybe a year as an associate or straight into academia is sort of the career trajectory for many professors. And it doesn't include, you know, building a book of business and actually doing those things. But if you are in the private practice of law, like I don't care if you're at the biggest firm or you're at a small firm or you're a solo, like you are in business for yourself. And your ability to generate clients, to manage your cash flow, to project manage, to attract talent, to recruit talent, to train talent, to retain them, to create opportunities, to teach others, to coach others, like all of those skills matter a ton because you are, I don't care, you listen, if you get anything from this podcast, it is like you're the biggest firm, you are still a solo. Like ultimately at the end of the day, and that's not like, that's not for everyone. If you want to go work for an insurance company, like that's a different thing. You want to go to work for the government, that's a different thing. But if you're in the private practice of law, the entrepreneurial spirit, and you don't, it's not rocket science, but you have to understand some basics of accounting. You have to understand some basics of taxation. You have to understand what marketing is and how to get clients. My advice for anybody, it's like, if you go to a firm, look at the lawyers who generate cases for the firm. Ask yourself, what is it that they do? What is it about them that allows them to generate cases? Because ultimately, like, it is not just doing great work. Like doing great work is sort of like the threshold. Like that is sort of like the entry into the arena. But actually succeeding requires those sort of entrepreneurial business skills, the willingness to put yourself out there, the willingness to cold call, the willingness to be criticized, the willingness to share your story, to have people say, you know what, this person isn't for me. But some real basics, some basics on marketing, some basics on business, some basics on accounting, and some understanding of really, like, businesses, you know, healthy law practices are also healthy businesses. Like, these are not mutually exclusive. And I think for some of my professors, it felt like business or marketing was like a four-letter word. And I'm like, no, that's really, to me, a foundational thing for a happy and successful law practice. Because if you don't do those things, like, you really can end up in a downward spiral of, I don't have money. How am I going to pay? How am I going to pay my mortgage? How am I going to pay my people? I don't have clients. You know, am I going to be fired? You know, do I need to be looking for another job? All these sorts of questions. And, you know, that's a huge amount of anxiety when you also have to deal with motions and you also have to deal with all the other things that a lawyer has to do. So absolutely think about those things. And you don't need to have a background in it like Maggie, but think about those things. Think about where you can find those resources and spend some time learning the basics of business. Now,
can I interject?
You can interject, Maggie. Absolutely.
Oh, sorry. I always have something to say. Other advice that I would give too, even if you're in like the early stages of just thinking about going to law school, would be to like think about what you want your brand to be and what you want to look like. And that can start with your social media presence. So making sure that you're putting out things that are appropriate and that are show what you're interested in, who you are. So that would be one place that I would suggest. Like, before I went to law school, I went through all my social media platforms and made sure that everything looked appropriate and was a reflection of who I really am. Another thing would be getting involved early in networking opportunities. So I joined the local county bar association. And even as a student, I'm out there, I'm going to those events so that I can meet people and learn more about different practice areas and places that I might want to learn more about. So really getting involved, even before you're a lawyer, even getting involved in different, you know, charity organizations or volunteer opportunities. It's really just being involved in your community to figure out where you want to end up and what type of work you want to do. That has been very helpful and beneficial for me. So that would just be something I would pass along as well.
Yeah. And, you know, you talk about, you know, chess and like 12 pieces ahead, and like, that's great. I really think when it comes to your career, like the Steve Jobs Stanford like graduation speech is like all the career advice like anybody needs to know. Like, you don't really need to read a book. Like, just read that talk. And I actually listen to it once a year. And I just, because I think it tells you what you need to know. And one of his points is like, you can't connect the dots looking forward. And so you never know when that event you go to, you're going to meet somebody who's going to change your career. Or you never know when that conversation, or you're on this podcast and somebody's out there listening and they're like, wow, I really think Maggie was insightful. I want to hire her. You can't plan like that. But like, if you do enough activity, those things will happen for you. And so it's sort of a little bit of a leap of faith, but you can't connect those dots necessarily looking forward. And I say this, I'm going to share how I ended up getting my first job. One of the things that happened is I was an intern in a criminal court in Meriden, Connecticut, GA7, doing things like, you know, in domestics and DUIs and trespassing and various low level crimes. And I was an intern at the state's attorney's office, and I went down and I just wanted to be in court. I didn't want to do criminal work, but I was just like, I want to see what a courthouse looks like. I'm a law student. I'm in the third year. I'm done with doing classes as much as I can. I want to be seeing what a courthouse is. I want to go into litigation. And so the criminal court gives you that opportunity. I got to try a speeding ticket case. But the thing that actually made my career was I lived in Enfield, Connecticut, and it's about 45-ish minutes to Meriden. And we were getting like a lot of snow in the northern part of the state, and in the southern part of the state, or middle part of the state where Meriden is, it was like snow rain mix. So the courthouse was open, but I was getting a lot of snow. And what I did is I said, you know what, I got to go down. I probably could have called my boss at the time and said like, hey, it's snowing, I can't get here. It would have been fine. But what I did is I said, okay, I can take a train down. So I took the train to Meriden and I walked to the courthouse, which is probably about a half mile from the train station. And that made such a mark on the prosecutor boss. And so I applied to a small firm. And what happened is they saw that I was at this courthouse on my resume. And one of the former judges was a friend of theirs. And so they said, hey, Judge Smith, would you call Jim Turcotte? And could you find out about this Ryan guy? Like, what's he like? And so Smitty calls Turk, and Turk says, oh, you got to hire him. Like, he tells him the story about the train, right? And so me taking the train to work in Meriden that day ended up getting me, like, that was the reference, because that was a sort of clear example that Turk could give of sort of my work ethic or drive or whatever. So yeah, get out of the classroom, like get out and meet people and do those things, because people notice. So can you, like, in sort of with that, and I know some of your background here, you have done a lot of things in law school, like working in different firms. Can you talk a little bit about that? Like how you got your jobs at law firms, what they've been like what you've learned. Those kinds of things.
Definitely. So I've been very fortunate. My goal during law school for internships and clinical placements was to really get as broad an array as I could. I really wanted to be able to try different areas of the law, because I'm looking for where do I want to be for the next 40 years? And I wanted to be very intentional with that and be able to say I tried many different things so that I would be, you know, as sure as I can be about where to go forward. So my first year of law school, getting an internship the first summer after law school, I went through my school's career development resources and applied for opportunities through that. And I was fortunate enough to be able to work with a large firm out of Hartford and worked with their medical malpractice group. And that was a great experience to learn about what does firm life look like, what does med mal look like. And really about the transition from a nursing career into a legal career. What does it look like? I definitely learned a lot about, you know, wearing scrubs every day and working three 12-hour shifts to the transition to a 9-to-5 Monday through Friday, wearing a suit to work difference. And that was very impactful for me. And they were a great group of people to work with. In my following year, I was able to, during the school year, I applied. This was another thing I just like cold emailed. I found a directory on Google for the Part A New Haven court system. And I said, hey, I'm really interested in this. Would anybody talk to me? Is there any opportunity? What do I do? And I was able to get an internship there with Seth Grabarski. He was amazing to learn from. We were able to.
Can I stop you right there? Can I stop you? Because this is like small worldville. I worked with Seth in Meriden, and I was hoping you would say Seth Grabowski. And Seth will definitely. Seth is a friend of mine, and he is a fantastic dude. And so he was there for my train thing. So I know Seth. So anyhow, for those listening out there, like this is like the small world that we inhabit, where I don't do criminal work. I worked with Seth 20 years ago. I served on an alumni board with him. Seth, if you're listening, you're a fantastic dude, and I hope all is well. And I'm not surprised that you were smart enough to hire Maggie. So go ahead, Maggie.
Yeah, I hope he doesn't mind the name drop, but he was just amazing to work with. I got to sit in on a trial that he was working with, and I got to see it pretty much from like the midway point to the conclusion. And I had the opportunity to work on portions of drafting motions and evidence compilation or review of evidence. So that was amazing to have that opportunity to work with him on that. But similarly, like just put yourself out there, figure it out. I was like, this is what I want to try. This is what I want to learn about. And I just Googled it. I was like, okay, courthouse in New Haven. And then I looked up directory of staff at courthouse in New Haven. And then just that emailed out until someone responded to me, until I found the right person. After that, I had the opportunity to intern at UConn Health Center. And that was amazing because I got to see the types of different roles that you could have as in-house counsel. And doing that, I was able to see also the interconnection between having a healthcare center, but also being a government entity. So I had never really seen both. Interning at Part A, I was able to see kind of what government work was like. And then I also had an internship previously at Hartford Healthcare. So I was able to see what in-house private work looked like. But this was the first time I had seen them together. So that was amazing. And I also got to see that being a lawyer in a position like that isn't always as clear cut as other roles might be. I was able to try things such as contracts, risk management, quality improvement. There were a lot of just different areas and different ways that a legal career could look like. And that really opened my eyes to that, that it doesn't have to be just drafting motions all day. If that's not your speed or the thing that you're interested in, it could be contract review. It could be interaction with insurance companies. It could be contract vendors. It could be reaching out to quality improvement and policies and making sure they meet the regulations. So that was amazing. I also work part-time as a law clerk at Bartlett Grippy in Cheshire, and they're amazing, amazing attorneys and staff to work with. That has been a wealth of information. I highly recommend, if you can figure it out in your schedule, to get a part-time legal job during law school if it's something that you can manage. It's a lot of work being able to manage school and working a part-time legal position, but it has been a wealth of information and a wealth of insight into what I want to do going forward with my career. So I highly recommend that. They've been very informative on giving feedback on how I can improve my research and writing skills and just about the process of litigation, because a lot of the things you learn in class, like you take civil procedure and you figure out the steps, but until you're really going through it, at least for me, I was like, I don't know what this is. I remember one time I got an assignment from an attorney at my first internship, and they were like, oh, I need you to draft a motion in limine. And I'm Googling LMA. And I was like, I can't find what a motion in LMA is. Like, I don't even know what they want me to do. So it's like, really, until you put yourself in those situations, you're not going to learn it. You're not going to know what to do. You're learning in law school pretty much just how to think like a lawyer. But really, those day-to-day things that you will be doing afterwards, I feel you don't learn until you're in an internship or until you're in a clinical position or in a part-time position. And then this summer, I was able to intern with a mid-size or a large-size firm that had multiple locations out of New Haven, Stamford, Guilford, and Waterbury. And I was able to try on many different hats there. I did some IP work. I did some med mal. I did some personal injury. I did some land use and zoning. So I really, my goal throughout my legal career was try as many different things as possible so that you can really figure out what you want to do going forward. And again, I would say utilize your career center and just whatever your ideas are. My biggest advice is just reach out to people. The answer is always no until you ask. And the worst people are going to do is not respond to you or say no. And then you're in the same position that you were before. So I think those are both great opportunities. And then even just like networking, like I mentioned, I've gone to different county bar associations or other events, and I've gotten job opportunities from that, from interactions with people saying, hey, this is what I want. This is what I've done. Do you have any opportunities like that? So those are my three recommendations.
Yeah, no, I think, a few things. My first trial I ever saw was Seth Grabowski trying a sexual assault trial. So that was the first trial I actually sat in court for and watched. It was a day-long trial. So we have that in common. And for those out there too, like who are listening to this and are in law school or thinking about going to law school, well, look, there are some people in the law school class who are like, hey, I want to be a prosecutor. They know from the beginning and like, that's it. And those people, like, actually Seth is one of those people who just wanted to be a prosecutor from when he was in law school, did moot court, did nothing but wanting to do criminal prosecution. But those people, I think, are rare. And for most people as who are lawyers, like, it is a series of careers within a career. So don't feel like you have to limit yourself. And also, like, look, the law right now is going to evolve very wildly and very quickly. And so, look, when I graduated law school, like, there was no, like, cannabis land use law, right? Like, your local drug dealer wasn't filing business permits for the local zoning commission, okay? Like, there's none of that. And there was no Bitcoin, or there was really no social media. Like, there were none of these things that are sort of like these big forces in society. Bitcoin, and, you know, there was no cyber liability insurance, and all these sorts of things. And we're, you know, society is getting more and more complicated. You know, you see the battles in labor surrounding AI and the Actors Guild and all of these sorts of things. So there's going to be new areas of law 5, 10, 20 years from now in your career that do not even exist right now. So yes, keep an open mind, try, and don't feel bad if you're that person. You know, the question I always hated getting asked was like, well, what do you want to do? And it was kind of like, well, I want to help people. I think I want to do civil litigation. I'm not really sure what that means. And you also touched upon something that I think is really critical, which is, like you said, you know, look, I learned the federal rules, and that's great. Like, that is great. Federal court practice is a very small amount of practice. Like, most litigation in this country is not federal court litigation. And if you're in a state, like, there are some states that follow the federal rules. Connecticut is not one of those states. So everything that you know about service of process and all these different things related to federal rules of civil procedure are probably the opposite in under Connecticut rules of procedure. So, you know, don't be afraid to ask. Don't be afraid to learn. As you're experiencing these things, don't be afraid that what you're doing is at odds with what you may have learned in law school, because law school is probably not going to teach you the local state practice rules, and as they differ from the federal rules. So, Maggie, we have covered so much here, and you're such a joy to talk with and to have on. And yeah, go do things like go to your law school career fair. I mean, I went to one night at UConn. I met you. I met Claire Sermer that night. I met Alejandro Cuenca, both of which have been guests. Listen to their episodes, plugging them. And I hired, you know, Alejandro to be a summer associate at our firm, and Claire to do our HR and build up our human resources department. So yes, go out and go to these things and stop by tables and talk. You just never know where it's going to lead. And Maggie, that is a great lesson, and really, I think, a great message for anybody out there listening. So, you know, I thank you so much for being on. Oh, you can stop me here if you don't want to answer this one. But I had this experience in law school, and I got asked about it. I got asked about it a ton. Can you plan a wedding while you're in law school, or does your whole life stop?
So I actually got married this May, and it's a lot, but I'm pretty type A. So like I said, I have my planner that I live by. So I would literally like plan time to meet with my fiance to say like, okay, this is when we're going to figure out the flowers. And then this is when we're going to figure out the invitation. And, you know, people might have thought I was wild because I sent my invitations out almost a year in advance. But I said, this is when I have time to do it. This is when I can manage it with school, with work, with planning the wedding. So you can do it. Your life doesn't have to stop. And that's one piece of advice I would try to say, too, is make sure that you figure out what's important to you in your life, and that you make time for those priorities as well. Your life doesn't have to stop when you're in law school. The people that matter to you, make sure that you make time for them while you're in
school. That is great advice. I also got married in law school, and after my first year, and was asked that a ton. So 20 years later, was still married. So the wedding went well, and the marriage has gotten well as well. So congratulations, Maggie, on that. And just, you know, you've listened before. We're at a cookout together. You get a burger. It could be a veggie burger, hamburger if it's meat. What are you putting on that burger for condiments?
Well, so if it's at a picnic, I don't know if they'd have all the things that I want. But if I could have the perfect burger, I would have avocado. I would have a sunny side up egg. And I would have a chipotle sauce on top.
That is very good. And that is usually the burger that I order when I go out to Plan B, which is like a local restaurant chain in Hartford. They have the, I think they call it the West Coast burger, which you just described. I think an egg does go well on a burger. And this is a bougie cookout. So we have all the condiments, we have everything. So you can have that. I'm usually a pickle, mayonnaise, and ketchup guy if I'm at a cookout. But I have to admit, I had a burger last night and I had ketchup and mustard, which was also delightful. A little bit basic, but delightful as well. So your West Coast burger, I do also dig. So, Maggie, thank you so much for having you on. If you want to probably connect with Maggie, she's on LinkedIn. You can check her out on LinkedIn, Maggie Murolo. And thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for joining Ryan McKeen in the Law Student Lounge, where real law students talk about their real lives. Are you a law student with a story to tell? Learn how you can share your story with us in the episode description. And join us next time in the Law Student Lounge.